young man courting the girl. He played a waiting game. If a maid refused him with tossing curls, he let the old earth take a couple of whirls. For as time went along, she came his way. As time went along, she came. But it's a long, long while from May to December, and the days grow short when you reach September. The autumn weather turns the leaves to flame, and I haven't got time for the waiting game.
September song was Mom's favorite. Good morning, family, friends, those of you in the room, those of you with us on Zoom. On behalf of my family, thank you so very much for being with us in these last few days of December. As you know, Mom passed in October, and we wanted to wait until now for the memorial, so that Cameron, Chandler, Gabrielle, and Dakari could be here. Grandchildren were everything to Mom. And very selfishly speaking, I'm glad I had those few months, because Mom left us so suddenly that the pain and the loss and the regrets, having these few months, it's allowed me to, I still have that, but it's allowed me to move past that, to remember what an amazing, wonderful, giving woman she was. Oh my God. And when I think about that, I then think about all of the things about Mom that makes me smile and laugh. Momisms. Mark and I were just talking the other day, when she ordered bacon, it had to be, right? Extra, extra crispy, right? When I go through her wardrobe, every other item of clothing has leopard print on it. We now lock the door in our house. When Mom was with us, 10 times a day she would say, Renee, is the door locked? Renee, is the door? And of course it wasn't. A lot of times I ended up getting locked out. We now lock the door. We call it channeling Mom. It's the way we hold on to her, the memories of her, how she was such a part of our life. And I can now hold on to what Mom said to us the day before she passed, when she was on the phone talking to Cameron and all of us were in the hospital room. And she said, don't be sad. She said, I've had a beautiful life. You know, you're supposed to honor a person's last wishes. You're supposed to respect their wishes. Mom always said she wanted to be cremated. Mom also said she didn't want a funeral service. She didn't want a memorial. She didn't care if we called it a celebration of life. And these conversations would always come up when either Shaka or myself would be coming back from a funeral. She wanted the program. She wanted to see the program. But she said, it was almost like a running joke. She said, if you have a memorial, I do not plan on attending. That was Mom. But I know this morning that Mom, seeing everyone in this room, and everyone on Zoom, she's pleased. Because whether you called her Granny, or whether you called her Aunt Dora, or Cousin Dora, or Miss Dora, or Mrs. Chenault, or Mom, she was a remarkable woman. And as long as we remember her, and smile about her, and remember the memories, she will always, always be with us. I love you, Mom.
Thank you for the blessings you have bestowed on our family. You have provided us with more than we could have ever imagined. You have surrounded us with people who always looked out for us. You have given our family friends who bless us daily with kind words and actions. Today, it has been 2 months and 26 days since Mom passed away. To say that I miss her is an understatement. It never gets easy. But I do notice that I've made some semblance of peace with her passing. I'm reminded more than ever of the other people in my life who have gone through this, and I regret the trite things I said to them before what I knew it felt like. Here in Cabru, Senegal, every morning at sunrise, Lola and Stormy, our dogs, visit our bedroom window, peering in as if to say it's time. It's time to honor our beach jog ritual. During the jog, we would pause just long enough to record a brief WhatsApp clip to forward to Granny, Renee, Shaka, Cammie, and Chandler, offering morning salutations and wishing them a blessed day. All of our lives, we looked to our mother for comfort and guidance. She was always there for us, helping us work through an issue or helping us gain perspective. No matter what, Mom had a positive demeanor. She taught us to value the wonderful moments in life and how to persevere in difficult times. Like her older sister, Aunt Betty, she always remembered your birthday and Christmas with a gift card. When I was young, I had no knowledge of Mom's difficulties, hardships, and losses. She was the fourth of seven children to the union of Willie J. and Virginia Coulter Taylor. Their family moved to Cincinnati, Ohio, where Dora graduated from Woodward High School, and then married the love of her life, the late Elmer Chenault, a.k.a. Brother Man. To me, Mom defined resilience. She had such strong faith in our family and was very giving and positive. Our house was like a central hub for family and friends. No one ever left hungry or without feeling a bit better than they did when they arrived. She and Brother Man had made remarkable sacrifices for their children to be afforded a level of comfort that still humbles me. As a child, my mother would tell us, this too shall pass. At first, I found this odd. What I was dealing with seemed like the most important and difficult thing ever. How would it ever be okay again? How would it get better? As I matured, I realized she was right. Life moves on, and we all have a choice to move forward or back. She was always choosing to move forward. To date, My biggest personal challenges have been losing first my father, then my brother, and now mom. They were all so important to me and influential in all aspects of my life. From my belief that I could do anything I wanted professionally to how to raise Dakari and Gabrielle. They were my go-to people, the people I wanted to talk to no matter what had happened, my mistakes, or what joy I felt. Their absence is painful and more challenging than I ever imagined. If you knew Mom, she was the watcher of everyone's back, the listener to everyone's problems, and the keeper of the family secrets. She wasn't technically a hoarder, more of a documentarian. I believe my mom's generation, the post-Great Depression generation, valued possessions more than most and made sure not to waste anything. It's that eat everything on your plate, young man philosophy. This used to drive my brother and I crazy at dinner. This is one of the few times we were forced to admit we were glad we had Renee, who would quickly swoop in to help us clean our plates at dinner time. Mom's gathering tendencies are a unique gift as they serve as a bridge between generations, ensuring stories and experiences will be passed on, allowing each of us to share stories and add to them to an ever-growing collection of experiences we call love. With her passing, Renee provided me with a large box of This Is Your Life evidence that showed that I not only existed, but thrived in a nurturing household and supportive community, all under my parents' watchful and loving eyes. Thank you, Renee, and thank you, Doc, for transporting a box to us here in Cabruce, which has allowed me to think about the past, the sad memories, and smile about the happy ones. Perhaps that's why she never was able to throw anything away. Maybe that's why she kept all these family mementos, realizing that when she died, the sum total of things would suggest a life larger than the one she lived. These days, my sister and I can joke about what Mom would do in a certain situation. However, it still pains me that they're not a WhatsApp call away when I need advice and want to share something special. It's a real loss, something you can't understand until you live it. Thinking about my mom's This Too Shall Pass message gives me the strength to carry on and live my life day to day, moment by moment. Like so many others who have faced the loss of family and friends, time does help mend our heavy hearts. But it's resilience that allows us to continue to move forward. This Too Shall Pass message doesn't mean that the problem, feelings, or situation will magically disappear. Rather, it can lead to a reflective thought process that helps you find the inner strength to address the challenge and continue to put one foot in front of the other. My mom would remind us, when we face obstacles and challenges, her advice will help us to choose to move forward, find solutions, and make the best of what life has to offer. Someone once said, a mother is a blend of strength, survivorship, experience, and insight, fancy, and reflection. Khalil Gibran said, I quote, the mother is everything. She is our consolation in sorrow, our hope in misery, and our strength in weakness. She is the source of love, mercy, sympathy, and forgiveness, end quote. I wish Mom was here to say, or to see, us gathered around to say goodbye. I wish Mom was here to tell us, now is not the time to cry. I wish I could hear her laughter again and tell her how much it means to me. I wish she could help me through another crisis or three. All these things and more I wish. Finally, to Dad, to Blake, to Renee, Yvette, Gabriel, and Dakari, to Shaka, Cammy, and Chandler. We always talk about the things people leave behind, the books, the photos, the clothes. But what about the memories left behind as reminders of a beautiful person who gave so much of herself? There are no words to truly say just what you meant to us. There are no words that can convey how much we miss you, your smiling face, your laughter, your IHOP breakfast order. Dear Mom, on this day of remembrance, I offer you my heart, overflowing with adoration for all the love, the support, and the strength that has shaped so many lives. You gave life and filled it with joy, peace, and love. As you look upon your children and grandchildren with blessings from above, may your heart be filled with the knowledge and pride that you are the most incredible mother in which love does abide. So we'll be sure to lead a life worthwhile in honor of such a brilliant mother. I'm forever thankful for you and to you. I love you with everything I have and more.
Amen. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. I think that the eulogy has already been preached. It was preached through the song, the September song. Because I don't know about you, but I could feel the warmth and I could feel the love that was generated in that song that your mother, Sister Dora Taylor, Chanel, loved. But before I go further, let me say good morning to each and every one of you. And to let you know that you have our condolences coming from my household with me. Because I feel, in a sense, a part of this family. I was honored that I was asked to do the eulogy. I couldn't say no. Not at all. Because I love this family. But let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, I thank you so much. We thank you so much for this day. For you have blessed us, Father, in so many ways. You've given us strength to go on when we felt like quitting. You wiped away the tears from our eyes. You have just comforted us. So, Father, we pray that you would just continue to be with us. Continue to love and strengthen us. Continue to be with us as you promised that you would always be with us. You promised that you would be with us always, even to the end of the world. So now, Father, as we move into this memorial service, worship service, ongoing service, we pray, Lord, that it would touch someone's heart and have them come forward asking, what must I do to be saved? In Jesus' name, I do pray. Amen.
Amen.
This morning I want to speak very briefly from the subject, there is room in my Father's house. It comes from John chapter 14, verses 1 through 3. It's a very, very familiar passage. It reads, "Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also." Today we come to celebrate the life of Mrs. Dora Taylor Chanel. We celebrate her life and we celebrate the legacy that she leaves behind. I thank God for the opportunity to have known such a wonderful person as Mom Chanel. I remember her warm and pleasing personality. I remember that. I remember her smile. A smile that energized you the moment that you entered into her presence. I remember her as being a quiet, dignified lady. Always kind. Always respectful to everyone that came in contact with her. I remember how she was always so calm, relaxed, regardless of what was going on around us. And as I stand here now and as I speak, I remember her with those dark glasses. To me, seeing her in those glasses, oh, it just brought joy to me. It brought a smile to me each time I saw her. Because I thought that she was so, so cool. But she loved her children. She loved her family. And I admired I admired her. I admired her late husband, Mr. Elmer Chanel. They were, in my opinion, a model. The model of a strong and loving and kind family that respected each other. And they respected their family. But not only did she love her family, but she spent time with her family. She spent lots of time. She participated in whatever they were involved in. I was told by her daughter Renee, I was told that her parents was always there for you. Whether it was in school, whether it was at a job, whether you were going through difficulties, you were always there. That is support that's given to children, children that you love. The grandchildren that you love. And if there were more parents and grandparents that spent this time with their families, with their children, oh, what a wonderful world this would be. There would be no more crime. There would be a reduction in mental illnesses, hatred, all of that would be reduced, I believe, because of the time that's put in through the parents, from the parents. But you know, Sister Dora, or Mom Dora, had so many different talents. She had so many different talents and experiences, of which I did not know. I didn't know that she was a gifted and talented artist. I didn't know that she was so experienced at skiing. I didn't know she was a cyclist. I didn't know she was a hiker. I didn't know that she was equestrian. I didn't know these things. I didn't know that she had traveled. She had traveled to so many different places, done so many different things. She had gone to the Caribbean, the Belgium, to France, and to the Netherlands, and the list goes on. And just not too long ago, She was in Egypt with her son Mark. And then she went to spend time with Mark and his family in Senegal. I didn't know these things. But I didn't know also that she was very adventurous. I didn't know how she went to Egypt and how she rode on the back of a camel. Can you imagine that? She's got more heart than me. She rode fearlessly on that camel's back, wearing her dark glasses, yes, looking like the woman king. Yes, yes, she was something else. But not only was Mrs. Chanel cool and lovely, but she was brave and fearless. A woman with more heart than me. And I say that because there's no way. I mean, I've been in Vietnam and military, police force, all over the place. But there's no way you're going to get me on the back of no camel. That just won't happen. But there was more to her. There was also a side where she could cook and bake. I didn't know any of these things. I would have been hitting her up for some of this cake and stuff that she would produce. Renee said that she had a Kentucky pound or German chocolate cake. She said it was just out of sight. Out of sight. Renee said that she loved to experiment. To experiment with a lot of fancy food. And I know Renee got that honesty. Because I can recall being in Washington, D.C., and Renee eating some fish about this big. And there's no way that I would be eating. But in addition to her travels, her son, Mark, said that his mother she got lots of joy from a plant called allali. You see, allali, for those of you who don't know, the ones I didn't know, is a beautiful plant. It's a plant that blooms in the late spring. It's short-lived, but fills the air. It fills the air with a powdery sweetness that some people would identify as a heavenly fragrance. Mark said he remembered. He remembered as a child how he would break a piece of it off of his neighbor's bush and took it home to his mom because Lolly brought her so much joy. Now, in my neighborhood, if you got caught breaking somebody, you'd get some rock salt or something. But anyway, it's a wonderful thing, God knows it is, when a son or when a daughter does things that brings joy and happiness to their parents. What more could you ask? That's love. That's love. So family and friends, I know beyond a doubt, I know that you loved your loved one. You love your mother. You love your grandparents. But the time now for her in this world has passed. That is gone. But what she left with you here in this world was great memories. Memories of which you will never forget. Life in this world is full of ups and downs. It's filled with trials. It's filled with tragedies. It's filled with circumstances of which we have no control on. But we who are Christians, we're taught that not to allow the pains of life to steal our joy. To steal our joy in the Lord. We are taught that we should embrace the brokenness in this world. We should embrace it with hope and confidence that there is joy in the Lord even during times of sorrow. You know, we try to sit here, we try to laugh and put on the smiley faces and be happy, but we know that at times like this, we are hurting inside. It takes a while, because I have sat where, just not too long ago, where you are sitting, and I am not over it yet. It's a hard thing to face. But it is doing home-going services, and that heaven and earth seems to meet. And our earthly thoughts become centered on a place called heaven. The glory of God and Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. It is during these times that we come together in faith that death is not the end. It is only the transitioning from this world into the next world. So we celebrate, we sing hymns of victory because another soul has been redeemed by Jesus Christ and has conquered the last enemy called death and has gone home to be with the Father who has a reservation for you laid up in the Father's house for all eternity. The Apostle Paul said that for the child of God to die and have the soul depart from the physical body is to be home with the Lord. So to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. On October 11, 2023, Mrs. Dora Taylor Chanel, a loving wife, a loving mother, grandmother, suddenly became ill. And after a short illness, made transition from this world into the next at the age of 86. Scripture tells us that the days of our years are 70. And if by reason of strength, they be 80 years, yet is their strength labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off, and we fly away. So God not only kept his promise to Mrs. Chanel, but he blessed Mrs. Chanel with 16 additional years on top of that, which means that she had found favor in the eyes of the Lord. So we ought to put our hands together right now and just give God some praise for what he has done for Mrs. Chanel. I hear one. You see, Mrs. Chanel has lived a good life. She's made a positive difference in the lives of so many people, especially the people that are here assembled. But now, her voice has been silenced. Her physical appearance, as we once knew it, will no longer be seen again in this world because her assignment is now completed and God has called her home to rest and reward. But again, she leaves behind so many precious memories. She leaves us with memories of a beautiful smile that lights up a room when she enters. Remember the times that she said, "I love you." Remember the times that she exhibited such humor and laughter. Remember all of those good times. Remember, these memories are things that she left with you, but she can't take them with her. But she is still there with you in your heart. So I want to know this morning, I want you, each of you, to know this morning that this service should not only reflect on the life and experiences of Mrs. Dora Taylor Chanel, but it should remind each of you. It should remind each of you how short life is and how rapidly our lives are drawing to a close. It should remind us that one day, regardless of who we are or who we think we are, we'll leave this earth. One day, in the twinkling of an eye, life in this world as we know it will be all over. We don't know the day, we don't know the hour, but what we do know is that no one gets out of this world alive. The Bible says it is appointed unto man once to die, and after death comes the judgment. At that time, God will judge each and every one of us, regardless of what we think, regardless of whether or not we believe. One day, we will stand before God, and God will judge us for the life that we live in this world. And it will be determined by the life that we lived in this world, where we will spend eternity. You see, someday our home will be moved from the earthly home, this tent or temporary body which we're living in right now. It will be moved to our eternal body, the heavenly body, which we will find in heaven, that was built by our Father, whose kingdom we expect to enter. The Apostle Paul said that we are confident and willing rather to be absent from the body and be present with the Lord. And I know that I'm right about it. How do you know, preacher? I know because Jesus said to the man, he said to the man that was hanging on the cross next to him, he said to him, this day you shall be with me in paradise. So I came to tell you this morning that there is room. There's room in my Father's house, and Jesus has already gone to prepare a place for you. And he promises each of us that one day he will return and take us with him. So let me very quickly examine the text and I'll get out of your way. In our text, Jesus tells the disciples, he tells them, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. He said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. You see, Jesus knew. He knew that, as you should think about it, he knew that his time of departure was at hand, and that he would be crucified. He knew that he was going to the cross, and he would be crucified and glorified through his death, resurrection, and ascension. Jesus knew this. This meant his work in this world was almost completed, and he would soon return home to the Father. So he took his disciples to an upper room. He took them to an upper room in Jerusalem for a final time of fellowship before going on to his trial and crucifixion. See, he wanted to spend this little time with his closest people to talk and to just have a good time before he departed. He told them that he was going away. He said, but where I'm going, you can't come. So, of course, they became a little afraid and off-centered. But he told them to let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In other words, you believe in God, and yet you do not see him. Believe in me, the Son also. So what Jesus is telling them is to have a complete faith. A complete faith, not a faith in God while lacking faith in his Son, Jesus Christ. But have a faith in him. So Jesus was preparing his disciples for his going away and what was to happen to them when he was gone. For he knew that they would be persecuted. He knew their faith would be shaken and tested. He knew all of this. He knew that they would suffer, some of them. He knew that they would be crucified, some of them, on the cross as he was about to undergo. But in spite of the consequences they would face, Jesus wanted to relieve them of their fears and bring comfort to their minds. So he's letting his disciples know that although he was going away, that he was coming back for them on that day. So he's letting them know also that there's room, yes there is, in his Father's house. There's room for you, there's room for me, that there's a place that's already prepared for us. But he also wanted them to know that when he comes back, that he will come in the air, and those who have died in the faith will be raised. The living will be changed, and the saved will be taken to the Father's house. There they will dwell for all eternity. You see, the Father's house refers to heaven, where there are many dwelling places for all those that are saved. So no matter what losses we incur in life, no matter how dark and hopeless things become in this world, no matter the valley or the storms of life that we endure, there is a place of peace that's already prepared, already reserved, already paid in full in the Father's house for those that are redeemed in the Lord. So I came to tell you this morning that if you're not saved, that you must be saved to meet Jesus Christ on the journey to the Father's house. Tell me, preacher, what must I do to be saved? Well, the Bible says in Romans 10:9, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. So I ask each of you this morning, I ask those who don't believe, to ask yourself this personal question. Am I saved? Am I saved? That's a question that only you can answer. Only you and God know. I can't answer. Nobody next to you can answer. Ask yourself, are you saved? Have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and as your Savior? For there is no other way. There's no other way, brothers and sisters, into the kingdom except by Christ. Jesus said that I am the way. He says that I am the truth, that I am the light, that no one comes to the Father but by me. So I want you to know the reservation in your Father's house is now being reviewed. Is now being reviewed. And those who have lived a godly life in Christ Jesus will one day be together again in that dwelling place not made with hands, eternal in the heavens, where you and your loved ones will all be reunited, those who have gone home to be with the Father before you will see them again. And there will be no more pain, no more suffering, no more sorrow, no more doctor's care, no more sleepless nights. there will be no more troubles in this world. For the Bible says that God shall wipe all tears from your eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be no more pain. For the former things have passed away. So I came to tell you this morning that weeping may endure for the night, but joy, joy. Let me hear somebody say joy. You're almost asleep on me. Joy. You got to wake up when you talk about joy. Joy will come in the morning. For in my Father's house, there are many rooms. So I ask for those that can stand or want to stand, to please stand. That's what I say. I ask that because there may be someone here. Someone here this morning. Someone who's out of the ark of safety. Someone who needs to know Jesus Christ. I offer you, as God has sent you here this morning, to open the doors to you. If you are here and you want to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, all you need. Confess with your mouth, Lord Jesus. Believe in your heart that God has raised you from the dead, and you shall be saved. It's just that simple. It says you shall be saved. It didn't say maybe, would be, could be. He said shall, which means it will happen if you open your heart. So much for this opportunity. We thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord God, for Sister Cora Taylor Chanel. We thank you, Lord, for all that you have done in her life and all that you allowed her to do in the lives of so many others. We all loved her, Lord, but now, Father, we have to let go because you loved her more. For this is our prayer, Lord, that we pray now unto him who's able to keep us from falling and present us, fathers, before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the all-wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forevermore. Glory to you.
Now, any family or friends who would like to? Good morning, Fran.
Hey, how are you? Hi, good morning. It's a hard day. I'm Fran Fatah. I'm the oldest of all the Fatah children. I spent a lot of quality time with your mom when the girls were much younger, and when you and my dad were away, and you know, all I could say is, like, you know, she had so much determination and love and focus and a great sense of humor, and you know, as I said, determination. And you know, she had strong opinions that she was not afraid to share and communicate. And, you know, she loved good food and good restaurants. And, you know, along with your dad, who was also super amazing and really focused on family and love, you know, they had such a tremendous, like, generosity of love, right, and that I really extended to me and my brother and my mother and everyone. I just wanted to be here to acknowledge that. I'm glad I got to see her the day she passed away. Just show my love because she was just an amazing, remarkable woman. My condolences to everyone. I will keep her love with me always.
Sunglasses, leopard print jacket, regal pose, and an infectious laugh, and also an incredible manicure, always. These are things that come to mind when I think of my grandmother. What many may not know is that Granny was terrified of dogs. She was bitten by a German Shepherd when she was in kindergarten, it ran across the schoolyard and bit her on the knee, and through her son, St. Bernard Bruce, and my giant German Shepherd Scout, Granny remained resolute in her tactful avoidance of all things canine. But when I got my small dog, Sven, something changed. She would sneak him and my sister's dog, Lottie, cheese and popcorn, and even hold him if I asked her to. In fact, many of the photos, most recent photos of Granny, feature her holding him. And my favorite made it onto page 4 of the program. And that was the thing about Granny. She was devoted to her family. From holding small dogs to moving across the country to be closer to her grandkids, she would do anything for the people she loved. I'll miss her adventurous and curious spirit, her sense of humor, and, most importantly, her honesty. She was one of the few people I truly believed when she told me she was proud of me. To the point where I honored her last wish of completing my final third-year practical exam. It was 60 minutes long. It was drug calculations, surgical gowning, anesthetic machine setup, suturing, and a dental exam. And it was a daunting endeavor for any veterinary student, but I actually got the call about her like an hour before I went into it. But I can say with complete certainty that she was in the room with me, coaxing me through each step. I know she was there because I almost didn't set up the right tube, but passed that one, so we did good. And I'm lucky to have had the privilege of calling her my grandmother, and I'll remember her each time I look at the leopard tattoo that she approved, that is on my leg. She hates tattoos, but she approved that one. Thank you.
Hi. I'm Gabrielle, I'm the second grandchild. One of the things that I'll miss the most about Granny is probably her sayings. One of her favorite, and the one she probably said the most, was wash up as far as possible, wash down as far as possible, and wash possible. I'll miss my last vacation with her and the search to find her crispy bacon. That wasn't me. Finding out her love for creme brulee, which she wanted to have every single day. Her love for big bags and leather-covered menus. The memories of when we were younger, when Doc and I would spend the night at their house and she would make us apple juice and cinnamon Pop-Tarts and bacon in the morning. And probably my most recent but favorite memory from this past July when I came to visit her. When I stopped by just because I was here for a concert, and we spent an hour watching Court TV. And I didn't know that she loved Court TV, but she really did. And one of my gifts from Granny that I'll probably always cherish is one of the last voicemails that she left me, where she said, good luck with everything you do in the future. And I know she meant that, and it means a lot, and I still have that, and I can still hear her voice whenever.
Dakari. So I always felt a special connection to Granny because I was born on her wedding anniversary. So whenever she would call me and say happy birthday, I would always say thank you Granny, happy anniversary, and we would chuckle together because Granny would love to laugh. Granny was a very giving woman and she never missed a birthday or Christmas call, and she would send me $100. When I was younger, I didn't look forward to getting older. I looked forward to that $100 because I felt like I could use it on anything. She would also send clothes on these holidays. And you know, when you're younger, you don't appreciate clothes because it's like, here's some more socks. But to this day, I have a couple pairs of socks Granny sent me, and they're the warmest socks I've ever had. And even in the hospital, a day before she passed, she leaned over to Aunt Renee, and she asked her, did you send the card his graduation gift? And we was like, yes, Granny, she sent it. Because that's just who she was. She always wanted to make sure everything was the way it should be. And she taught me patience, because she would drive me crazy whenever we would go out. And I'd finish my food, and Granny would be over there meticulously cutting it, eating her food, taking her time. And I just wanted to go back to Aunt Renee's house to go in the pool or something. And even, I remember a couple times we would go to Target and she would drive. And, you know, as a Need for Speed New Yorker, I wanted to get there as fast as possible, but Granny would stay off the highways, go in the back roads, and get to that Target. But I have many fond memories of visiting Philly, and I think I even spent the summer at Granny's house. And she was everything you wanted in the grandma. She was nurturing, and I don't think I've ever seen Granny scream. And so, you know, that helped a lot when I was a kid. So I always remember Granny for the remarkable woman she was.
First, I am honored to speak about my mother in love, Dora Chenault. She made many of great things possible in my life, my loving husband, and my beautiful, loving children. I would describe my mother in love as loving, adventurous, humorous, and a family woman of many talents. She is the original Dora the Explorer. She traveled with us to France, England, and Egypt to fulfill her childhood dream of seeing the pyramids. Last year, we all thought that she would cancel her trip to Senegal. Instead, on her 86th birthday, she proved us wrong and returned to Africa. She had so many talents. Her pottery and paintings have a prominent place in our homes. She could help the current generation as she knew her angles and could have been a model. She never took a bad picture. I would also describe her as the Chenault family CEO. And she always led with love, making many of sacrifices. She always wanted us to be together as a family. She was a loving daughter, having taken on caregiving responsibilities for her mom and then later on for her brother. A loving wife of 50 years and a loving, doting mother and grandmother. She sent out birthday cards just to make you feel special. She was an unofficial spokesperson for the state of Colorado. I never thought that she would move, but once she started having grandchildren, she gave up that title and moved to the East Coast. For her, her grands could do no wrong, and she made every effort to spend time spoiling them. As a mother in love, she embraced not only me, but my entire family. She knew my grandmother and always called to wish her happy birthday. She and my mom called each other sis. My great nephews called her granny. With me, she shared her experiences being a young mom and never missed an opportunity to show and tell me that she loved me. Here's one of her last messages.
Hi, Yvette. It's Friday morning. How are you? I'm doing pretty good. I just called you to see how you were and to talk about Mark's birthday yesterday. We talked to him a couple of times. I didn't get to send him anything because, you know, I had no way of sending it. By that I mean I didn't have an address or anything. So when you go there, if you go before he returns, I'll be sure to have him something by then. I've talked to I'm showing my age. I've talked to Gabrielle, and I must call Dikari today. Call me when you have a few minutes. Love you.
And she ended every conversation that way. Ecclesiastes 3 tells us, there is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens. I have so many great memories with my mother in love that although she is not here with us, she is with us because she will never be forgotten. She holds a special place in all of our hearts, and I will miss her dearly.
I just want to announce that all of the menus and restaurants throughout the world are now safe. That's all I'm going to say, but Dora collected menus with permission most of the time and whatever the other circumstances required. So she, but menus were her thing because food was a big deal. And, you know, but menus is kind of like when you get to choose what you want. And she made a lot of choices in her life. Family was always number one, and number two, and number three, and number four, and number five. And it's something for all of us to reflect on as we honor her legacy.
Much more than I ever knew, and I think to myself.